tape to Rena Bernstein. You started to talk about the hut that you lived in. How did the hut look?
It was a shack. It was very primitive. The only heating system was a big Russian stove. There were two rooms. This, you know, big Russian stove, they start on the floor and go right up to the ceiling, and they even have a shelf on the top for someone to sleep up there. So there was that, the Russian stove, which warmed both little rooms. In one room, there were two little cots. I and Yannick slept on one cot, and he slept on the other cot. There were a couple of windows, and then there was this kitchen. The grate opened, and Magda was extremely superstitious, and she would look at the coals in the grate, and she would predict all kinds of mayhem, you know, what was going to happen. And one of her favorite themes was, oh, the house is going to burn down. And this, of course, scared the daylights out of me. And I remember that that's about the time when I stopped sleeping. I wasn't able to sleep. The only time I could sleep was when it was raining. In my mind, I felt if it's raining, then it's not going to burn down. The rain will quench the fire. So I was afraid to sleep at night because of her. And that's not the only thing. She's going to break a leg, and this is going to happen, and that is going to happen. So every morning, she would read the coals and scare the daylights out of me.
What was the relationship between Magda and Yannick?
They were together for the war, but they were not married. They just lived together for the war, during the war, and I don't really know anything else. I know that Yannick had a fiancé in another town, whom I went to visit at one point. But more about this hut, there was no bathroom in it. There was no facilities for hygiene at all. So if you wanted to wash, you would have to go to the stream. There was a stream not far away with a bucket and bring in water for everything, for cooking, for washing. And on the back porch, there was a dung heap. It looked to me like it was 3 or 4 feet high. Just people just relieved themselves on the back porch. And in the summertime, the stench and the flies were just unbelievable, just unbelievable. And I remember that I also was, I mean, in that kind of hygiene, I had worms, and every time I went to the bathroom, there were little white worms crawling in the feces, and I remember that. I remember that I had nits. If I put my hand like this through my hair, you know, I came out with running all over my hand. I think that in the warm months, we were able to take a bath in the stream. But in the cold months, and Poland is very cold, and there's a long winter, snow must be on the ground for 6 months, if not more. And it snows. I mean, most of the winter, the snow was higher than the windows, so that it was like twilight in that little hut all day long, because the snow covered the windows. It was so high. I never went out in the winter, so there were 6 months or 7 months when I didn't open the door. I didn't have shoes, so I couldn't go outside.
Where did you get your clothes?
I don't know. I guess I didn't have that many clothes. What I had, I don't even know where they came from. But I was in this, confined to this tiny little hut with these two little rooms for the whole winter, in which I didn't talk to anybody. I don't remember having a word to say to anybody or anybody talking to me. It was an extremely strange and terrifying thing to be living with people that you never spoke to, that you were terrified of, and you could not even escape from their presence for months at a time. I couldn't go outside. As soon as it got warmer, I disappeared. As soon as I woke up, I disappeared into the forest, and I had I loved the forest. It was the only thing I had. I would spend hours lying on my back looking at the clouds, and it was a fantasy world I was in. I imagined that I was walking in the canyons of the clouds. I was going in and out of these caves. And I remember imagining that it was a world, that I would escape and I would live in that world, in the clouds. And I spent hours just on my back walking in the clouds, literally.
How far into the forest did you walk?
Oh, I went all the way in, and I remember sometimes coming across gypsy camps. It seemed to me like they were gypsy camps, because there was campfire, there were sparks coming up with the smoke, it was, and people sitting around. I never got close enough to be seen, but I came across these camps, and who knows, maybe they were not gypsy camps. Who knows what they could have been.
Do you remember how they were dressed?
Not really. I don't think I remember how they were dressed.
Did they see you?
No, they never saw me. No, I was very careful not to be seen.
Did you see any other groups of people in the forest?
No.
How about animals?
Birds. I remember birds. I don't remember animals, but I loved the birds. And I felt safe to some extent happier in the forest than I was with people. I was now terrified of people completely, and I had no contact with them.
While roaming in the forest, what thoughts and feelings did you have of your parents?
I no longer thought about my parents. I think that trauma of having been really ripped away from them like that was so traumatic that I just blocked everything. And I was living in a fantasy world of nature, of the forest. I remember at that time being taken to the local church, somewhere, not in the forest, but on some outskirts. There was a town and there was a church, and I was baptized. I remember eating the wafer, and I remember that the priest would pat my head, and he seemed to me to be kind. And I had a feeling that maybe he knew who I was. Maybe he knew that I was being hidden.
When you were hidden, were you told that you have to have another name?
I was given another name. My name was Irena Konkol. Konkol is the name, Janek's last name. I took his last name.
What was your relationship supposed to be to him?
Not sure.
Did he tell you to behave in certain ways?
You know, they didn't. And you know, sometimes Germans came down the road to that hut, and when I saw them, I usually ran behind the hut or down or away so no one could see me. I knew I was in terrible danger. But it so happens that once they came unexpectedly, and I wound up on a German's knee, and he was saying something like, he has a girl like this at home, something like that. It seemed to me that's what he was saying. I don't know what language he was speaking, but I remember winding up on his knee.
Do you remember how you felt?
I think I was just in shock the whole time. Everything, you see, no one experience was worse than another. It was like a living hell to me, the whole thing.
How long a period did you stay in the forest? What did you do when you got up in the morning?
It depends. If it was relatively warm, spring or summer, as soon as I got up, I didn't eat. I just went into the forest. I stayed in the forest alone until it got dark. Then I came home, and usually there was a little table in the kitchen with two chairs. If I would sit up on the chair, Magda would give me a piece of bread and butter or whatever they were having, a piece of rabbit or whatever was in. And I would eat it. And I would go to bed, and that's all. I don't remember conversation. I don't remember anything.
What else can you tell me about the people who hid you?
The people who hid me really were very noble, because they were not, first of all, they had gotten no money or anything for doing this. And they knew, and everybody knew, that they were putting their lives on the line to save a child that they didn't know. They had never seen me before when Yuzhu had arranged for this. Yuzhu knew a man called Stefan, who was Yannick's brother, who lived in a town before the forest, near the forest, close to the forest. And through Stefan, he got Yannick. But one time, I remember this, after I think I had been there about a year, Stefan came, it was spring, he came to the hut, and I was there. It had not yet, I guess I had not gone to the forest that day, or maybe it was still too cold. And in front of me, he sat down with Yannick at the table, at this little table in the kitchen, and he told him that a Christian family had been murdered because they were hiding Jews in his village. And he said, "You are putting us all in danger, and you must get rid of her. You must take her in the forest in the morning and shoot her. Nobody will know."
And you heard this?
I was right there when they were talking. And Yannick said, "But what if her parents come back?" And Stefan said, "Her parents will never come back." And I don't remember what I felt. But all I know is that I had a feeling of unreality, always a feeling of unreality, because I was living in a fantasy. I went to bed, and I didn't wake up for 24 hours.
Why do you think you did that?
Because I didn't want to get up, because I thought I would be killed. And I thought, I just escaped. That was my whole way of dealing with everything, escaping into fantasy, escaping. I slept. And when I woke up, it was twilight of the next day. It was more than 24 hours. And I remember the shock of, like, touching myself. I'm here. I'm alive. I didn't believe, I don't know, in my childish way, I understood that he had not done it and that I was alive. And that was the last I heard about that. So, you see, they were very brave to do this for a stranger, for a strange child.
What other frightening experiences do you recall?
Well, confusing experiences. There was a time when, you know, the Germans were sort of combing the forest for Jews, and the area became too dangerous for me. So Yannick took me to what I understood was his fiancée, Vilka, in Lvov, and asked her to keep me. It was winter, and I have a memory of being in this house. Now, I had been used to living in a little hut, and I was in an apartment, and the bedroom had like mahogany furniture, very sturdy furniture. It was like a really nice bedroom, and I was sleeping in it, and I woke up early in the morning, and on my night table were two cookies I had never seen before, with jelly in the center, like I think they're called Linzer cookies. I'd never seen anything like that in my life, and I ate them, and I was, you know, I was like in awe, and I never mentioned it to anybody. That was like, I don't know, it's just, I guess, the equivalent of a miracle happening to me. It was a miracle.
This was Yannick's fiance, Vilka.
And of course, when I was with her, I had to go to church regularly, and I had to learn the prayers, and I was like watched carefully. But as it turned out, it was dangerous for me there too, because I could have been denounced by people. She said that there was some excuse that I was Yannick's niece, or I was a cousin or someone. I was there about 5 months, I believe, and then I was taken back to the forest.
What other things do you remember about the forest?
It's not so much events as a feeling, who I was.
Can you describe that?
I was completely unable to relate to people. I was totally isolated, encapsulated in myself. Terribly, terribly frightened. Terribly frightened all the time. Felt that I belonged to no one. I felt that I was part of the forest. I felt that I felt like a wild child. I felt that the stream and the trees were my family, the flowers and the clouds were my parents, and nature was my mother. I felt that. I felt that I didn't belong to humanity. I felt I wasn't human, but I was part of nature.
Do you remember feeling that?
Yes, I remember that feeling, that not only in the forest, but afterwards, for many, Many, and maybe I still do to some extent. Felt completely estranged from human beings, completely.
Were you ever sick while you were in the forest?
Toward the very end, my mother's younger sister, Hanka, could not stay where she was being hidden, and she came in a sort of a desperation to Yannick, to the forest, if he could keep her a few weeks. And during that time, I remember I was sick, and I had fever. And my aunt, whom I knew very well, I was four when I was taken away, denied that she was my aunt. She had to deny this. So she had a gold tooth, and she had removed that. She had the monograms on a sweater, her monogram, and she removed that. And I remember the conversations with her, like, "You are my Aunt Hanka." "No, no, I'm Panya Stefcha. I'm not your Aunt Hanka." "But that sweater, that's Aunt Hanka's sweater." "Oh, no, I'm Panya Stefcha." So it's like this really cuckoo thing going on. And at night, I was sick, and she would be crying over me. And I was just crying over me all night.
Did she comfort you?
She tried to comfort me. But every time she kept repeating, "But I am Panya Stefcha. I'm not your aunt. I'm Panya Stefcha." It was a very strange thing.
When you were baptized as a Christian child, were you aware that you were Jewish at the time?
Oh, yes, yes, I was aware.
Tell me about that.
I was aware that I was Jewish when I was taken away. I mean, first of all, my mother and father were, my father was part of the Enlightenment. He came from a shtetl. He grew up in a little shtetl, Sanok, with the Jews in Sanok. They were very religious, and he wanted to be a doctor. And of course, the community would look down on that, because he first had to learn Polish, and he didn't know the language of the country. He learned knew only Hebrew and Yiddish. He went to a Talmud Torah, very religious upbringing. So what he did was, he went to a person who lived near the railroad station, a neighbor, and he changed clothes there. He put on secular clothes. He went to school. He came back, he changed clothes again in order to go home to his village, in order to go home to his house. Well, my mother's family was also very religious. Lesko had the Jewish community. It was very religious. And when I know that I spent a lot of time in my grandparents' homes, and I know that it was a very religious home. I had, you know, even though my parents were part of the Enlightenment and they were secular and they spoke Polish at home, my extended family was very religious.
So when you were in the forest and you were baptized, what was your thinking or feeling about that at the time?
You know, after being in the forest, I think right from the beginning, I became not only homeless physically, but homeless in my soul. And it no longer seemed strange to me, no matter what happened. I really was homeless. In my soul, I had, you know, I was never going to see this life that I had again. I don't think I rationally thought about it, but when I actually, the church was comforting. I remember the music, the colored windows, the whole aura of it was comforting.
When you were taken to the church from the forest, what was the occasion?
I don't know. Don't remember the occasion. I remember that at Christmas time there was a Christmas tree with little candles and little cookies.
That was where?
It was actually in Vilka's house, but also in the shack there was some celebration, something. So I was not Jewish, I was not Christian, I was nothing. At that point, I had no associations with people at all. Okay. I was a tree, and I was a flower, and I was a stream. That's what I was. I was not a person anymore.
When you said earlier that Yannick and Magda said to forget your parents, When did they tell you that?
In the beginning, right after I was brought there. It was, I don't remember exactly the words, but it was something like, you are not to talk about it, you will never see them again, finished. You are now Irena Konkol. I remember I was 4. Can you imagine how little a 4-year-old is?
Do you remember when how you felt when they said that?
I don't know. All I know is that I kept imagining all the time for weeks that my parents were staring at me from behind the trees, that they were watching me. I think that's how I saved my sanity.
This you were doing all along?
For weeks afterwards. Until I gave up. I gave up even hoping or feeling. I just gave up. Something happened to me. In order to survive, really, in order to physically survive, I had to cut my feelings off completely. It was intolerable and impossible to go on living with the kind of feelings I was feeling. Terror, abandonment, just imagine being torn away and thrown into a forest where nobody even talked to you. At 4. In order to survive, I had to cut off my feelings and live in fantasy, which is what I did. And then I began to look at the clouds and walk in the clouds. Yeah. I remember having dreams then. I had one obsessive dream for years. And the dream was, and it began in the forest, that I was running through the forest and the trees would meet overhead and there was just like a tunnel. And I was running and running and running, and these dreams would go on. I could be running 100 miles. I was running somewhere through the forest. I had to get somewhere. And eventually, I came to a white flower. It was like a white lily in the forest. And this lily bloomed only once, and I came, and that was it, whatever that means. I think it means that somewhere inside of me, if you had to go through and dig through tunnels and tunnels and tunnels, there was still a Rena somewhere. That flower was Rena. But it was buried.
At the time you were having the dreams, would you call them good dreams or nightmares?
No, they're not good. They were not good dreams. I don't know. They were obsessions. They were obsessive dreams. And they were certainly didn't make me happy. They were like crazy dreams. They were just intense, full of anxiety, running, hiding for years after the war. And during the war, I was obsessed with hiding, with not being seen, with running places and hiding. I was doing it all the time, even when I didn't need to do it. Running and hiding, and I remember such unfathomable loneliness, alone in that forest, alone. And actually my whole waking life during the warmer weather was alone in a forest or in a field. Of course I became very intimate with the plants that grew there, with the birds, with the flowers.
Did you talk to the plants and the birds?
I didn't talk to them, but I communicated with my heart to them. The colors, and I think that's why I then began to paint when I grew up. The colors, I remember the blue of the cornflowers in the grasses and the fields, the little berries, the mushrooms, the pines, you know, the smells, the feel of it. This became my life. The forest became my life. I think it was the most intense experience of my life. The forest became my whole world, my whole life, and the people were an abhorrence to me, all of them.
And so when you came home after being in the forest all day, were you ever asked by, excuse me, by Yannick or Magda, where were you?
Wasn't a middle class kind of place. Maybe that's the way people raised peasant children. It wasn't a question of where were you, how do you feel, what do you want, what do you need, nothing. You know, it's just like you grew up like a weed, you know, in a field, like a weed, and that's what I felt I was, a weed, you know, uncared for. Nobody cared unwashed, you know, you just got a little bit to eat. Nobody cared about anything about you.
When Magda was with her daughter, a four-year-old daughter, Stasia, what was that like? What did you observe?
Well, I observed that Stasia was a crybaby. Of course, I also thought she was extremely lucky. She could cry. I wasn't allowed to breathe, not let alone cry, let alone say anything negative, let alone complain about anything. I had to really stuff everything. What she would do is she would hang on her mother and she would whine, I want this and I want that, and the mother would sort of put up with her. But the mother's concern was for her, and it never extended towards me. I was always the child in the corner, the child who just stands there. As a matter of fact, I also felt at 4 and 5 that I had to be useful. So if Janek would walk into that little shack, I immediately grabbed a broom, meaning I'm going to clean. I felt I had to be useful because I was nothing. And I had a feeling I was nothing to them, except perhaps putting them all in danger, but I was nothing to them. And that maybe, I know they did a very courageous thing. Maybe they just didn't know how to relate to me. Maybe it was impossible to relate to somebody who was so traumatized. Well, I don't know what the story was, but I was so unbelievably lonely. It was unbelievable. I don't think I can even face those feelings now. I'm trying to. In all these years, I'm trying to.
Did you ever cry?
No. I couldn't. I didn't have feelings anymore. I was now living in a fantasy.
How many years did you stay in the forest?
2.
Between what ages?
Between 4 and 6.
Do you know when you left the forest? On what date? Or the circumstances?
Yes. One day, I was again in the yard holding a chicken over this bloody stump. It was in the afternoon, and Magda cut the head of this chicken. The chicken was running around, and then Magda said, "There's somebody coming up the road." And I looked, and there was Stefan, the brother, Janek's brother, with a woman. And I remember the woman was very thin and frail, and they came into the yard, and I knew it was my mother. And my mother came up to me. But you know, the funny thing is that I had no feelings. I have feelings now, but at that point, I was just too disturbed now. I had no feelings. She came, she brought a little blue raincoat, and that evening she slept there with me in the same bed, and she tells me that I couldn't stop saying, my mommy, I'm so happy you're here, my mommy, but I don't remember that.
What do you remember?
I remember being a dutiful little girl, as I was, trained. I packed all my little things in a bundle and tied them in a kerchief.
And I remember what you had? What did you have?
The whole bundle was like a little thing. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was a shirt or some underwear. I don't even think I had underwear. It was not underwear. I had no underwear all that time in the forest. I don't know. It was a little shirt or something. And I went with her. And I remember she was wearing a mustard-colored dress with tassels on the pockets, maroon-colored tassels and a little pockets here. And I remember the dress. Before the war, she wore that dress. This is the dress she was saved in, and she saved the only dress she had. And that's another story.
We'll continue on the next tape.